Okay, good morning. Today we will see what is meant by supervised learning and unsupervised learning. We have finished first unit of data mining. Now we are moving to the second unit. That second unit will deal with supervised learning techniques. Apart from these, also there are some other supervised learning techniques that we will see in unit 3, and then unit 4 will be dedicated for unsupervised learning techniques. In this particular unit, we will see what is meant by supervised learning techniques, then what is the problem of classification, what are different classification techniques, KNN, decision tree, Neo-Bayesian classification based on logistic regression. So when we are saying supervised, it is having two types, out of which one is discussed in this particular unit. The other part, that is the part of regression. Whenever we say supervised, classification and regression, these are the two things that come under supervised learning. So out of which classification will be studied in this particular unit and regression will be studied in the next unit, third unit. And in the fourth unit, we will see what is meant by unsupervised learning. So basically, learning, you all people know, learning means adding to our knowledge. Whatever knowledge right now we are having, suppose one incident has occurred to you, suppose your knowledge level, suppose there is some unit for measuring knowledge. So suppose your knowledge is say 3 units. With respect to a particular thing, your knowledge is 3 units, and then a particular, then some incidents happened with you, and after that incident your knowledge is 4 units. So your knowledge level has been increased. It means that you have learned through this experience. So during that experience you have learned, and if that happened during that particular experience or incidents, after the incidents, your knowledge level is more than what you had before the experience. So it means that that experience has enhanced your knowledge. So if experience enhances your knowledge, then you have learned something, then you have gone through the process of learning. So whenever your knowledge level, previous knowledge level and the present knowledge level, if there is some positive difference between them, if our present knowledge level is more than what we had yesterday, then it means that during this one day we have learned something. And this is the human behavior. We are learning through experience. Now whenever this is experience, we are experiencing certain incidents, we are going through that particular incidents. In case of machines, what is going to happen? Suppose a particular model is there, suppose a particular algorithm is there, and that algorithm or that computer machine is having efficiency or knowledge level say 3 units. And once we pass this data to this particular algorithm, so this algorithm will now look at this particular data, it will try to enhance its knowledge, and if it comes out as 4 units, so its knowledge level has been enhanced. So it means that it has learned during this process, and this is nothing but a machine learning. So machine learns out of the data. We human beings are learning through experience, and whenever we say experience, it is nothing but a data. It may be quantified or it may be non-quantified, but basically it is a data. So we human beings are also learning through experience or data. Same thing we are trying to impose on machines. Now these machines are expected to learn from that particular data, and that particular learning will be called as a machine learning. So if a particular machine has increased its knowledge before the experiment, from the level that it had before the experiment. So if a particular experience we are giving, if we are throwing a particular data to that machine, so before accepting that data, what was the knowledge level of the machine, and now what is the knowledge level of machine? Knowledge level of the machine in the sense, whatever model we are having, we can track efficiency of that model as a knowledge. So if that efficiency is 90%, so that much knowledge machine is having, and now after this data, efficiency of that particular model is now 95, so it has gained some knowledge from that particular data. So this is nothing but a machine learning. So whatever intelligence we are having, we as a human being are having, we are trying to implement that intelligence in a machine. So that is nothing but artificial intelligence. So whenever machine learning, artificial intelligence, there is a very thin boundary. Basically, they cannot be treated differently. Machine learning in the sense, machine is learning out of the data, and every time when we throw different data, machine has to change the algorithm. Every time we will not be there to change the algorithm. Machine should adjust it, and that is nothing but artificial intelligence. Without explicit need of programming, machines will be expected to learn out of the available data, and that is the machine learning. So whenever we talk about machine learning, there are two prominent types of the machine learning. One is supervised learning and unsupervised learning, the other part. So as this picture demonstrates, you must have got that what is meant by supervised learning and unsupervised learning. In this particular setup, supervised learning, there is someone, facilitator or teacher, he is teaching, and this particular person, we can suppose this particular person is a machine. So this machine is learning under the supervision of the teacher, whereas this particular machine is learning without anyone's supervision. So whenever you are learning under someone's supervision, now when I say under someone's supervision, what does that mean? It simply, we'll see in detail what supervision means and what non-supervision means. So those things will clear. Now here, this particular person, he is learning, and whether, suppose a paragraph is there, and from that paragraph, what meaning comes out? This person will try to find out that meaning, and whether whatever meaning that person has extracted out of that particular paragraph, whether that meaning is true meaning or not, whether that paragraph means that only or it means some other thing, in order to tell this, there is a teacher. Whatever he has done, whatever she has done, this particular lady, whatever she has done, whether that is correct or wrong, in order to tell this, there is someone, a knowledgeable person. So this knowledgeable person will tell whatever you are doing, whether that is a correct way or not. If there is someone like this, then we call it to be a supervised learning. And if there is no one, if on your own you are performing something, you are learning something, then that is unsupervised learning. A classic example of this is what Arjuna learned was a supervised learning, and what Eklavya learned was a unsupervised learning. There was no one to supervise Eklavya, whereas Arjuna learned the things under the supervision of Dronacharya. So whenever there is someone who is supervising the learning process, then that learning process will be supervised learning process. And if there is no one to supervise the learning process, then that learning process will be called to be unsupervised learning. Now, we'll see in detail what is supervised and what is unsupervised. Supervised learning is a machine learning method in which models are trained using labeled data. Now, this labeled data, focus on this word, labeled data, it stands for the supervision. So whatever data we are having, that one is labeled. So every time there should not be a person. Even if there is some machine which is telling us whether it is whatever we are doing is correct or wrong, that is also a supervision. So, or there should not be a machine also. Just there should be a chart where on one chart it will be given that what tasks are correct and what tasks are incorrect. So do's and don'ts like of thing. Suppose there is something, some banner is there, and do's and don'ts are given on that. So what you are expected to do and what you are expected not to do, those charts are given. It means that supervision is being done. So every time supervisor will not be a person or machine. Just what is correct and what is not correct, if those things are given, it simply means that you are being supervised. So whenever data labels are provided, it means that your work, your learning process is being supervised. So suppose a data is given, our classic credit card data, suppose. So for that credit card data, X1, X2, X100, suppose these are the variables. First one, as usual, say age, X2, gender, X3, type of credit card, limit of credit card, whatever variables we have studied before in the previous lecture. So you can consider all those variables over here. And this is the data on, say, 10,000 persons. So on 10,000 persons, we are provided with this particular data. So bank has given us this particular data, and we want to come up with a model which will tell us, suppose a new customer arrives, 10,001 customer, this customer arrives, this is a fresh new customer, it has arrived, that particular customer has arrived right now at the bank. So we'll ask, what is your age, what is your gender? So we'll take readings on X1, X2, X100, on this particular customer. So all these readings on the customer will be taken, and now based on that, that bank officer has to decide whether to allow him a credit card or not allow. If that particular person is expected to default the payment, then we are not going to allow the customer to have the credit card. If that customer is a good customer, if he is going to repay the payment, then we are going to allow the customer to have the credit card. So we have to decide based on these variables, based on the information on these variables, we have to decide whether that customer should be allowed or not allowed to have credit card, or we should be firstly able to identify whether that customer is going to be defaulter or not. So defaulter or not, if that person is going to be defaulter, if he is going to default the payment, then we are not going to give him credit card. So our concern is based on these many things, based on these many things, we wish to find whether the customer is characterized, whether the customer is classified as a defaulter customer or a non-defaulter customer. And for that, this 10,000 data on 10,000 customers is given. Moreover, all the 10,000 customers, whether they were defaulter or not, that information is also given. So this will be a class level. So now, if suppose this whatever reading on this 10,001, suppose this is say Ramesh, this new client customer is Ramesh. So whatever reading is there on Ramesh, whatever variables we have observed on Ramesh, whether suppose there is someone Ganesh who is having same entries, whatever entries are there, X1, whatever age of Ramesh is there, same age is there for Ganesh, whatever credit limit Ramesh has asked, Ganesh is also having same credit limit. So if it is exactly matching, then if we know whether this customer has defaulted the payment or not, based on that we can take decision for this customer. So for that, this class level has to be given, whether this is a good customer or not, that we should know. Unless and until whether Ganesh is good or not, we will not come up with the information, come up with the prediction that Ramesh is good or not, because Ramesh and Ganesh, they are having matching entries. So exactly matching. So if age of Ramesh is 23, Ganesh is also of age 23. 10 lakh this credit limit Ramesh has asked, and exactly 10 lakh Ganesh is having as a credit limit. So if all these things are matching, then if Ganesh was a defaulter, then Ramesh, there are more chances that Ramesh will also be a defaulter. And if Ganesh is not a defaulter, then Ramesh with this particular configuration will also not be a defaulter. It means that whether Ganesh is good or bad, that there has to be someone to tell us whether Ganesh is a good customer or not, not a good customer. So someone should tell us, and that someone is nothing but a class level. This class level is telling us, if class level is yes, it means that customer is going to default the payment. Class level we have used for a defaulter. Class, our attribute is whether the person is defaulter or not. So yes, it means that customer is going to be defaulter. So this is not a potentially good customer, because he is going to default the payment, he is not going to repay the payment. And this, whether Ganesh was good or bad, that information has been given by this class level. So a small child will roam here and there, and suppose if he goes near to the gas burner, and if there is some utensil placed over the burner, that person, that particular child will not know whether that whether keeping hand on that utensil is dangerous or not, because there is no one to supervise that child. If there is someone to supervise the child, then he will tell us that don't put your hand on this particular utensil. If there is no one, then he will directly put his hand on the utensil, and he will get a very nice experience. So to say, whenever there is no one to supervise you, then the learning process becomes difficult. Under the supervision of someone, learning process becomes quite easy. So once you know that Ganesh, this person with this particular configuration is going to default the payment, so you will, whenever a new customer arrives, you will try to find out whether this entry, whether this sample entry, all these entries, whether they are very near to this exact matching phenomena, that is rare. एग्जैक्टली एग्जैक्ट एज और एग्जैक्ट क्रेडिट लिमिट मैचिंग ऑल दिस थिंग्स मेनी ऑफ द वेरिएबल्स आर गोइंग टू बी कंटिन्यूअस इन दिस पर्टिकुलर मल्टीवेरिएट ऑब्जर्वेशन मेनी ऑफ द वेरिएबल्स विल बी कंटिन्यूअस सो देर इज वेरी लेस प्रायोरिटी दैट दीज टू एंट्रीज विल मैच बट वी आर नॉट एक्सपेक्टिंग देम टू एग्जैक्टली मैच इवन इफ दे आर वेरी नियर टू ईच अदर देन वी कैन से बेस्ड ऑन दिस इन्फॉर्मेशन दैट गणेश हैज डिफॉल्टेड द पेमेंट एंड रमेश इज समवन हु इज लुकिंग जस्ट लाइक अ गणेश whose configuration is very near to Ganesh and therefore Ramesh is also highly probable to default the payment. So these things we learned because of these particular. So we already know who is a good customer and who is a bad customer. It means that someone has supervised us. They just not haven't thrown some customer, just this particular data. They haven't thrown this particular data to us. They could have thrown this particular data and could have asked us go and do the analysis. But they are very nice people. What they have done, they have thrown this particular data to us. Moreover, they have told that these out of these 10,000, these are the good persons, these are the bad persons. It may happen that they have given you two bundles. So one bundle of documents of persons who have defaulted the payment and other bundle will be of the persons who have not defaulted the payment. It means that they have given us the information that these are the persons who have defaulted the payment and these are the persons who haven't defaulted the payment. So it is a supervised learning. So whenever class labels are given, we know that what is going to be good or bad. Just I'm for the sake of simplicity, I'm talking about good and bad. Most all the times it won't be good and bad. There can be means universe is not black and white. There are always gray shades. So every time you will not have dichotomous classification. Sometimes there will be more than two categories also. But just for the sake of understanding, treat it as good or bad. So someone is there who is telling us that putting hand on a utensil on a burner is bad, and not putting it on that particular utensil is a good thing. So in this way, someone is supervising us, and here that class level works as a works that performs the role of supervisor. So whenever class levels are given, it means that we are given with the information that what is good and what is bad, who are potentially defaulter customer and who are not defaulter customers. So this is a supervised learning of kind of thing. And now suppose some new bank manager has arrived at that particular bank, and he has thrown just this particular data. You don't need class level, just do analysis with this particular data. These class levels are not given. So they will just throw this data, they will not provide you class levels, and they will ask, come up with analysis. At that time, whatever analysis you are going to do, that is unsupervised learning, because you don't know who are good customers, who are bad customers. Because in that case, you will not be able to identify whether a customer is defaulter or not. What you can do is, out of this available data, you will just try to find out clusters. Now, if you explore this data graphically, you may come to know that there are two clusters, there are three clusters. Accordingly, you can apply some clustering technique and you can come up with three clusters. So this, suppose out of 10,000, 4,000 customers, any 4,000, not necessarily first 4,000, any 4,000 customers will belong to this group A, next 3,000 will belong to this group B, and 3,000 will belong to groups. We can just do this directly. We can tell to bank officials that we will have this particular analysis. Out of 10,000 customers, we have identified a group of customers who are having same behavior, and those are clubbed in this group A. There are 4,000 such customers. Then there are 3,000 customers who are looking like each other. They are not exactly the same, but whatever distance measure we have considered, based on that, they can be treated to be equal, or whatever differences they are having, distance they are having, that is in acceptable range. And therefore, we have clubbed all those customers to form group B. And similarly, we have formed group C of 3,000 customers. So whenever a new customer arrives, then whether that customer should be classified as customer belonging to group A, group B, or group C, that can be done, because centroids of all these clusters will be known. As we know these entries, 4,000, 3,000, and 3,000. Therefore, centroids of these clusters will be known. So whenever new entry comes in, whether that new entry is near to A, centroid of A, or near to centroid of B, or near to centroid of C, based on that, we can classify this particular entry to either belong to A, B, or C. That is the only thing we can do. bank official should decide whether this is more acceptable configuration to banks, or this is more acceptable, or this is more acceptable, because they haven't told us what is good and bad, what is bad, who are defaulter and who are not defaulter. So we will just have a clustering kind of thing, and we will hand over that analysis to the bank officials. Then they will come up with certain things that yes, these are the potentially good customers who will repay the payment. These are the customers who are not going to repay the payment, and these are unpredictable. Means some of them have defaulted, or it may happen that they are paying the payments, but they are taking more time than the average to pay the pay the loan or that credit card amount. So likewise, whenever we are having a class label, it works as a supervising tool. In that particular case, whatever we are learning, that is supervised learning. And in case of absence of class label, if class labels are not given, and in that particular situation, whatever analysis you are doing, whatever learning you are doing out of that particular data, that learning is unsupervised learning. So a simple funda, if class labels are given, learning will be a supervised learning. If class labels are not given, learning will be unsupervised learning. So this label data, the presence of label data makes the difference. If label data is given, then these are the labels. So suppose it may happen that now this credit card data is there. Now suppose these are the 10,000 customers. These are the 10,000 customers. And suppose the data on those 10,000 customers is only given on X and Y. Only two variables are there. Suppose instead of these many variables, say X and Y, age and say income. Only these variables are given, and this is the plot. So suppose these are the customers. Suppose this is the data of say 100 persons. Now, for any particular point, this X represents this, its X coordinate represents its age, and Y coordinate represents its income. So here, some are the blue points and some are the red points. So blue points are those points. These are the customers who have repaid the loan, who have not defaulted the payment. And these are the customers who have defaulted the payment. So they are denoted by red. So here class labels are given. Whatever data is given for that particular data, class labels are given, because every person, you can imagine that there are 10,000 persons standing in a queue, and on the forehead of each person, there is a label. A barcode kind of label is fixed on that particular person's forehead. That label will read as I'm a defaulter, or on someone's forehead it will be written that I'm not a defaulter, I'm a honest person. So likewise, you can imagine there are 10,000 persons, and on the forehead of every person in those 10,000 persons, there is a sticker which reads as I am defaulter or I am not defaulter. Either I am defaulter will be there, or I'm not defaulter will be there. So this is just an imagination. Now 10,000 persons will not be there, but data of those 10,000 persons will be there. So whenever we are going in a bank, and if there is some queue, you must have seen that on WhatsApp or Facebook. If there is a long queue, then what people come? So the India is people of smartest people. So you may have seen that instead of waiting in a queue, instead of standing in a queue, what people do, people just put their handkerchief there or put their shoes there. That will be a token of their number. So whenever after sometimes, and they will go and sit somewhere. So whenever they come, wherever their shoes is, that particular will be their number in the queue. So likewise, the shoe represent the person, or handkerchief represents the person. Likewise, this data is representing the person, and that data is now being labeled. Instead of putting sticker on person's forehead, now we are putting sticker on that data. Whenever we are putting sticker on the data, it simply means that we are putting the data, putting the label on the concerned customer. So what label we are putting? This, whether that person is having class label as yes or no. So this is also a label kind of thing. So instead of writing I am defaulter or I am not defaulter, what we can do is we can have two stickers, one of red color and one of blue color. So on the persons who are defaulters, on their forehead, we can stick a red ribbon, and we can just have a red sticker on their forehead. And the persons who are making the payment, we can have a blue sticker on their forehead. So it is just like a labeling, putting a sticker over that particular data. So we are just sticking something, some information to that particular data. So whenever we are labeling the data, it simply means that we are having a class label for that particular data, whether that is a defaulter or non-defaulter kind of thing. So whenever this thing is given, it is a label data, because labels are given. These are labeled with a different value, and these are labeled with a different value. So such kind of data is label data, and whatever learning we are going to perform using this particular data is going to be a supervised learning kind of thing. So supervised learning is a machine learning method in which models are trained using label data. In supervised learning, models need to find the mapping. Now whenever we are provided with label data, this y values, suppose this is a response variable in our statistical concept. So this is a response variable, and these are the predictors, or we can say independent variables. So x1, x2, xn, these are independent variables or covariates, and y is the response variable that we are calling as class label in machine learning language. So whenever this data is provided to the machine just come up with some expression that will identify y based on these values, x2, xn. So it will find out the function y is equal to f of x1, x2, xn. Once it finds out the function, what is that function which determines the y value of x1, x2, xn? What is the value of y? What is the value of y that we are going to estimate based on values of x1, x2, xn? For that, we need to have a function that will map values of x1, x2, xn to y. That will map values of x1, x2, xn to y. So whenever we are provided with...
Hello, sir.
Whenever we are provided with the data...
Hello.
In which there are certain class labels, then we will just come with certain phenomena, we will come with certain model that will take values of x1, x2, xn, and based on some function, that based on that function, it will try to estimate y. So it means that whenever predictors are given x1, x2, xn, we will try to find a function that will map values of x1, x2, xn to y. Once that function has been established, we say that learning process has been completed. Once that function is found out, then we can say that learning process is completed, and now we are in a position. Whenever we are knowing that function, whenever we are having that particular function, it means that now we are in a position that whenever a new customer arrives, based on values of x1, x2, xn on that particular person, we can predict value of y. So that function, the purpose of learning, supervised learning, is to find function that will take these values x1, x2, xn as inputs, and y as it will throw y as the output. So function that maps values of x1, x2, xn to y, determination of that function is the basic aim of supervised machine learning. That is the basic thing that we are going to do in supervised machine learning. So in supervised learning, models need to find the mapping function to map the input variables with the output variable. So we will need to find a structure like this, y is equal to f of x. So this x may be here, if multivariate case is there, then this x will be, say, x1, x2 up to x100. Whatever response predictors are there, all those predictors will be considered, and function will be applied on those predictors to get value of y. And this function will be determined such that it will get aligned with this data. So if we are using method of least square, then this function will be such that whatever it has predicted, whatever value of y it has predicted, and whatever actual value of y is there, so sum of squares between them, sum of squares of differences between them has to be minimum. So likewise, based on the situation, f we define in different ways. Once we determine f, we say that we have learned the data, and now we are in a position, say, of y for any new customer whose x data is available.
supervised learning needs to train the model. The supervision is nothing but class level, which is similar to as student learns things in the presence of teacher. Student learns in the presence of teacher. Just hold on for a minute. So supervised learning needs supervision to train the model, which is similar to as students learn things in the presence of teacher. So that teacher will work as a supervisor. Supervised learning can be used for two types of problems. Supervised learning, now just focus on this paragraph. Supervised learning needs supervision to train the model, and that supervision is being conducted by the labels, which is similar to as student learn things in the presence of teacher. Now, whenever we are learning from the data, whenever we are coming up with this particular model, there are two things. Here, class labels are given. Okay. Now, the problem was whether that customer is going to repay the payment or not. Instead of that, now suppose some new manager comes in and he says that, okay, customer is going to repay the payment, but I'm not happy with that. I want to know the number of days within which customer will repay the payment. So just repaying the loan is not enough for me. I want that loan to be repaid in minimum number of days. So in that particular case, his data will look like this. This X1, now in how many number of days customer is repaying the loan, if this is the basic problem, then obviously we are tackling with those who have paid the loan. If someone has not paid the loan, then in how many days he has paid the loan, that question doesn't make sense. So now we will focus on only yes data. Yes, in the sense who has repaid. So in terms of defaulting, the customer will have class label as no. Customers hasn't defaulted the payment. It means that he has paid the customer payment. So whoever has paid the loan, suppose out of 10,000, there are say 4,500 people who has paid the loan. So on those 4,500 people will have already, we are already having this particular data X1, X2, X3. Now this Y, it will not be yes or no kind of thing. This Y, is my voice getting to you? Okay. Okay. So this, just hold on a minute. So now again, we are going to talk about that data only, X1, X2, XN, same data we are having. Now this Y, this response variable, earlier it was just yes or no kind of thing, whether customer will repay the loan or not. That was the class level. Now here, whether customer will repay the loan or not, that is not the question, because we have considered data of those persons who have repaid the loan. So obviously that repay is going to be yes for them. So that class level will be yes. But now that class level, we are not going with that class level. Now our class level Y is number of days taken to repay the loan. So within how many days customer is repaying the loan? Within how many days customer is repaying the loan, that is our concern now. So here, yes, no, like things will not happen. Someone will repay in 1 day, someone will repay in 2 days, someone will repay in 3 days, someone may take 40 days. Likewise, now this Y is not a label kind of thing. Now, if we are assigning red and blue color like this, so here, we will run out of the colors because there are many entries. So we cannot assign each entry. We cannot assign one color to each entry. So here the difference is class label in earlier case was categorical or qualitative, whereas here the class label is quantitative. So every time class label will not be categorical kind of thing. Sometimes, and even if it is categorical, every time yes or no type of categories won't be there. There can be more than two categories also. And even in some cases, class label may be numeric. it may be numeric, it will be a quantified thing. So such data also needs to be analyzed, whether we can learn from this particular data. Here also we can come up with certain model which will predict value of y based on the input data. So y is equal to f of x. This function again can be determined based on this particular data, and here y will come out as a quantified value. So numeric prediction is considered. So this is nothing but predicting value of y based on value of x. So here, whenever a new customer arrives, for that particular x, what is going to be y, that we are predicting. Here we are predicting that value, and here whenever a new customer arrives, we are classifying that customer to a family of defaulter or non-default. So just see the difference in terminology. Here we are classifying a customer, here we are classifying a new customer to available two populations: population of yes customers, population of defaulters, and population of non-defaulters. So whenever a new customer arrives, we just classify it that this customer belongs to yes family or no family. Here we are not having family, here we cannot talk about classification because these are quantified values. So here we are predicting its y value. So problem of classification and problem of prediction. Classification in the sense we are, both things are predicted, classification or prediction. In both the cases we are predicting only, but in the first case we are predicting the categorical value, in the second case we are predicting the numeric value. And therefore, in order to understand the difference, I am talking about predicting over here. So this is a prediction kind of thing, and this was a classification kind of thing. So in supervised machine learning, based on whether the class labels are categorical or quantified, we can come up with two different things, two different learning methods. One, this method is a classification method, where based on the available data, we'll build a model, a classification model, so to say. That model will be used in order to, when a new customer arrives, that new customer will be classified based on this model to yes or no, if there are only two populations, yes and no. And here we will come up with a model that is a regression model. Basically, whenever we are having this particular setup, y is a numerical or quantitative variable, this particular model is called as a regression. So here we are building a regression model. So in regression model, once we have built this particular regression model, whenever a new customer arrives, for that particular customer, what is going to be the value of y, in how many days he is going to repay the loan, that can be determined based on this. So whenever we are saying supervised learning, based on the nature of class label, it has two types. One is classification and the other one is regression. Now classification you have already studied in multivariate analysis. Discriminant analysis, whatever we have done, parent populations, two normal populations, based on those parent populations, we have come up with a certain threshold value, and for a given random vector x bar, we have come up with delta prime x bar, delta prime sigma inverse x bar kind of thing. So this is a scalar. So this scalar value will be compared with this threshold value, delta prime sigma mu 1 plus mu 2 something, Fisher discriminant function, that scalar value will be plotted over here. And if this particular value for the observed sample, this is a scalar quantity, even if sample is vector, we have made certain transformation and we have come up with a certain scalar. If that certain scalar falls beyond this, then we assign that particular observation to the population of pi 2. If it belongs before this, it belongs in this particular region, then we assign that observation to pi 1. So this is a classification. Two populations, pi 1 and pi 2, are there, and whenever a new observation comes in, we classify that observation to either pi 1 or pi 2. This is a problem of classification. But here we have considered parent populations. So every time we will not go with the parent population. If data is quite bulky, then finding population for itself, that doesn't make sense, because your data is such a bulky that data itself can work as a population. So you don't have to go and search its parent. That data itself is its parent, data itself is a population. Therefore, distribution fitting and such things won't happen over there. So these are the data driven techniques. As told earlier, data mining, this is a data driven technique. We will not go in distribution fitting, or that from that statistical perspective, we will not see the data. So supervised learning can be used for two types of problem, classification and regression. In classification, class labels will be qualitative. In regression, class labels will be quantified or numeric. Suppose we have an image of different types of fruits. The task of our supervised learning model is to identify the fruits and classify them accordingly. Now suppose you are having a suppose you are having a factory. In that particular factory there is a say machine, and here we are having in that particular industry only, suppose in a garden there are different plants. Some are of apples and some are of oranges, and in this particular company juice is being extracted out of these fruits, and so orange juice bottles are being manufactured, and then apple juice. So these two are their products. Now suppose it happens that these particular apples and oranges, they are stored in a container, and unfortunately whoever are these workers, they are putting these all in one container. So this particular container contains apples as well as oranges, so they are mixed with each other. So now what we have to do is we have to assign someone the duty of segregating this. So apples need to be separated and oranges need to be separated. Then these apples will be sent to extract juice for out of them, same for oranges, and then we'll come up with these bottles. So there has to be some person who will differentiate apples and oranges. Now this is a repetitive task. There is no much deal of intelligence required over there. So this particular task can be computerized. What we can do is we can have say 100 apples. So standard shape, standard color, all those things will be considered, and we will take these 100 samples. Similarly, we'll take 100 oranges. Now these 100 oranges and 100 oranges and 100 apples, these will be provided to this machine. Now machine, it will accept these apples and oranges. It means that it will accept the features on these apples and oranges. So x1, it will be whether that is perfectly rounded or it is somewhat distorted rounding. So yes or no, suppose x1 will be yes or no. Suppose x2 is radius of that particular shape, x3 is maximum length from one. So what can be the maximum length of that particular fruit? So maximum length of the diameter, if that is not a perfectly spherical, then what is the maximum length of diameter that can be considered as x3. x4, it will be indicator of a color, whether that is a properly red, pink or orange in color. So likewise x4, suppose it may happen that x4 that will just denote the amount of redness in the color. As we know, every color is combination of RB, red, blue and green, RBG. So every color can be considered as a combination of these RBG. So whatever color this particular fruit is having, what is the level of redness in it, what is the level of greenness in it, and what is the level of blueness in it. So that numeric quantity can be extracted out, that information can be given to the machine. Now if all these data is given, we can still have some more variables also in order to increase the efficiency, and finally we will give this particular data to the machine, and we will tell him that this is an apple. Then we will give another data to the machine and we will tell him that this is an orange. So now that machine is trying to learn. So what happens if these are the variables, then what is special in between them? Therefore, we have called these to be apples. So these apples, we will try to have a function based on these that will predict whether it is apple or orange. So this machine, once this data is given to the machine, then machine will be in a position to classify whether the given fruit is apple or orange. So once it has been trained perfectly, now what we will do, we will take exam of that particular machine. We will bring 10 oranges and say 8 apples. Now here there will be some that other calibration kind of things that can be done. Here there will be a camera, so in front of camera there will be say a place will be there, on that particular place there will be a storage place, on that particular place we will put this particular apple over here, and now it will capture this particular image, then it will identify what is the amount of redness, what is the amount of blueness, what are the diameters, all these things will be. Even we can have a 3D camera over here, this particular, or here this particular whatever shape is there, whatever storage unit is there, that can revolve around itself, so that this particular camera can capture images from all the sides. This will move and then it will capture images from all the sides. Once that images are captured, this data will be gained out from that particular fruit, and based on that, whatever function we have come up with, that function will be evaluated, and this particular here there will be a screen. On screen it will be shown that it's an apple. Likewise, suppose if we put orange, then whether it gives the message as it's an orange or it's an apple, we can study that. Suppose on these 18 apples, it correctly identified these oranges to be oranges only and these apples to be apples only. So 100% efficiency will be there. So likewise, we can have efficiency measures. And once we found that efficiency to be satisfactory, then we can implement this particular in our industry. So this person, employing this particular person and giving remuneration to some salary or wages to that particular person, instead of that we have built up a machine. That machine will identify whether a fruit, whatever fruit we have given to that machine, is apple or orange. So this is nothing but a pattern recognition. So that machine recognizes the pattern, whatever pattern is there in the data, it recognizes, and then based on that particular information, in future it correctly identifies the object. Now it is just an object, it can be any other thing, and accordingly, in whenever we do biometry, whenever we go in front of certain camera, that camera identifies us and it says that welcome Chandrakant Garg. So it means that that particular machine has identified me as Chandrakant Garg. So my information will be there in the database, but every time I will not look similar. Suppose my face has become oily, so at that time my image, whatever image that machine is capturing, that may be different than whatever it has in the database. So that variability, how to deal with that variability, that also we need to tell to the machine. So in this way, these machines are trained, and once they are trained properly, then we can use them in real life. The task of our supervised learning model is to identify the fruits and classify them accordingly. So to identify the image in supervised learning, we will give input data as well as output for that. So class labels will be given, whether this is an apple or whether this is an orange, that will be told to the machine, which means we will train the model by shape, size, color and taste of each fruit. Now taste, if it is a machine, then that taste point may or may not come into the picture. Once the training is completed, we will test the model by giving the new set of fruits. The model will identify the fruit and predict the output using a suitable algorithm. So once it has been trained, then we can just throw any fruit out of apple and orange only, because it has learned only these two things, only these fruits. So if we put apple near to that machine, it will correctly identify that it is apple, or it will correctly classify it to be orange. So this is supervised machine learning. In unsupervised machine learning, what happens, class labels are not given, so we are provided with only data. So whether suppose if we consider any particular mall, so what are the customers, this is the first customer, what amount of purchase he has made, what is the total number of commodities he has purchased, what is the average amount of time he has spent in that particular mall, what was his family size, means how many number of persons he accompanied. So it may happen that if there are more number of persons from the family, they are coming over there, they are more likely to have purchase of large amount. So for that, we can think like that, whether that person is accompanied by their family members, and if yes, then how many family members are there, what is his age, what whether he has means all other aspects which can make any sense to the problem under study, we can consider data on all those. So if data is collected like this, and this data is given, there is no such class label kind of thing. Suppose, so in that particular case, or in the earlier case, if only credit card data is given without the class labels, then we just have no option than to group these particular observations. So we'll just group, we'll just have subgroups out of these populations, and that subgrouping is nothing but clustering. Or what we will say that if we may it doesn't make unsupervised machine learning to be less efficient than much supervised machine learning, because supervised machine learning, a bird is sitting on a plant and we are firing, we are killing that particular bird using bullets. Unsupervised machine learning is like killing a bird which is flying in the air, because here we don't know class labels, and that is the challenging task we are going to perform. Whenever class labels are not given, in that particular case also, we are not saying that there are no class labels, so we are unable to have analysis of that data, go and bring the class labels. We are not going to do. Whatever available resources are there, we are going to analyze those resources. So what we are going to have here is, firstly, we can have grouping of these 10,000. Suppose there are 10,000 such entries. These 10,000 entries will be grouped in three subgroups. So this is kind of clustering. Using some distance measure or using some clustering technique, we can classify these observations into subgroups or clusters. This is first thing. Secondly, what we can do is, now suppose this is the credit card data. Now suppose there is a person who is having age, say 25, other one is having 25. These are males. Now from these available data, we may come up with the conclusion like there is no male in the data. Suppose for some customers, or suppose there are some females also. Suppose for some customers the credit limit is 3.5 lakh, for some 4.5 lakh, likewise. But observing this data, we can come up with information like there is no female who is having credit limit greater than 3 lakh. So all the females in the data are having credit limit less than 3 lakh. This may be the finding of the data. So this is nothing but the pattern in the data. This is the association. Now it may happen that if the person is female and if her age is less than 40, then there are more chances that he will go for a platinum credit card. So out of this available data, suppose here it is a card type. So some will have platinum, some will have other credit card types. So suppose if we consider females in this particular data, if we filter the data for females only, and in the age column, if we consider less than 40 age, persons with less than 40 age, then it may happen that all the customers, all such customers are having platinum card. So this is the pattern. This is the association between these things. So female with age less than 40 are going to have platinum credit card only. So this association, or in DMART also, if this was the data of DMART, then out of the available data, we can that milk and bread, that is a standard problem in data mining. We may come up with certain information that whoever has bought milk, whoever has purchased milk, has also purchased bread. And this data is from Western countries, and therefore that those particular things are happening over there. In India, we can consider whoever has brought shoes has also brought socks. So a person, if he has bought shoes in that particular storeroom, then there are more chances that he will also buy socks. Or it may happen that suppose someone has purchased battery, then there are more chances that he will also purchase cells for the battery. So these are the association. Whoever purchases battery is also purchasing cells. And if this data tells us that there is, out of 100 persons who have purchased battery, out of those 199 persons have purchased cells. So it means that whenever we are arranging these items in our mall, we should keep cells near to the battery. So in a particular in that particular mall, wherever we have in whichever cupboard we are storing battery, nearby we should also keep cells, because whoever is purchasing battery, they are more likely that they will purchase the cells. So these kind of associations in the data can also be identified whenever data is unlabeled. So even if data is unlabeled, we cannot do analysis of that data. This is not the thing. Still, we can do the analysis, and that is somewhat challenging thing. So the two things, classification sorry clustering as well as association. These are main unsupervised machine learning types. So my supervised machine learning types are classification and regression, whereas unsupervised learning types are clustering and association. So unsupervised learning is another machine learning method in which patterns are inferred from the unlabeled input data. The goal of unsupervised learning is to find the structure and pattern from the input data. Unsupervised learning does not need any supervision. Class labels will be not be given in clustering and association. Class labels will not be given, but still we can find patterns within the data itself. Instead, it finds patterns from the data by its own. This particular algorithm by its own finds some patterns or structures within the data. So unsupervised learning can be used for two types of problem, clustering and association. To understand the unsupervised learning, we'll use the example given above. So unlike supervised learning, now suppose we have given certain fruits. Suppose we have given 200 fruits to that particular machine, and we haven't said to that machine that this is an apple, this is an eye, this is an orange. Now suppose a child is there, say a very small child is there, say he is of 1 year old. He doesn't know what is orange and what is apple. And if we just throw those oranges and apples on the floor, and if that child is sitting over there, then he will just, as a matter of curiosity, he will just classify these to be oranges and these to be apples. So he will pick up this particular fruit, he will keep that particular fruit over here, he will pick another fruit, he will keep here. So that particular, if you ask that what is this fruit, he doesn't knows the name. That particular child will not know the name of those fruits, but still it will be able to make two clusters out of the available data. How they are looking based on that, because other things that person, that child may or may not be knowing, just based only on the size, based only on the color, and based only on the feel. If that child takes a particular fruit in his hand, then what is the feel based on that? What is the feel of that touch? Based on that, the person, that child will keep one fruit on other side and other keep one fruit on this side and other fruit. If that particular other fruit is having some different characteristics, then that other fruit will be stored on the other side. So that child has classified, but without knowing the class labels. No one has told that this is apple, this is orange. He never had earlier idea. This is the first instance when that child is exposed to these fruits. But still that child will be able to classify it. This is nothing but a cluster, because here class labels will not be given. So even if we don't know the class labels, based on how they look like, similar looking objects will be classified in this one group and these will be other similar looking objects. So this is a kind of clustering. So even if we don't tell the machine that these are fruits, these are oranges and these are apples, but still that machine will be able to group, it will be able to distinguish those fruits, and those distinguished groups will be nothing but clusters, because we are not sure that all these will be apples, all these will be oranges. So we'll not be calling this group as group of apples or the class of apples and this as class of oranges. So this will not be a classification. This will be a clustering kind of thing. So this is about unsupervised learning. So whenever class labels are given, that learning in that particular context will be called as supervised learning. And if class labels are not given, then learning will be called